Good afternoon. I am going to talk on Allerno palsy. I thank Dr. Hitesh for giving us an opportunity to share a few thoughts about the nerve palsy. Allerno palsy is caused by damage, compression, trapping around the elbow joint, and this occurs due to compression of the nerve at the level of the elbow called as cubital tunnel, or at the wrist what's called as Guyon's canal, and the muscle atrophy and the weakness predominate the clinical picture. The ulnar nerve is the largest unprotected nerve in the human body. It is unprotected by muscles or the bones. So injury is very common in these patients. So this ulnar nerve where it enters into the cubital tunnel behind the medial epicondyle. Ulnar nerve is the continuation of the medial cord of the brachial plexus and derives its fibers from the C8 and T1 nerve root. From there it comes. It has got the various branches and it goes up to the little finger and the medial part of the ring finger. At the elbow it enters into the two heads of the flexor carpi ulnaris. In the forearm it descends along the ulnar side of the flexor distum profundus, and it is covered by the upper half is covered by the flexor carpi ulnaris. About 5 cm above the wrist, it divides into dorsal and ulnar branches. In the forearm, it gives 3 important branches: the muscular branches, the palmar branch of the ulnar nerve, and the dorsal branch of the ulnar nerve. In the hand, it travels down the ulna. The ulnar nerve enters in the palm of the hand. The ulnar nerve and artery passes superficial to the flexor retinaculum. It passes through a canal called as Guyon's canal. It is above the flexor retinaculum. It gives 2 branches, the superficial branch and the deep branch of the ulnar nerve, which supplies the adductor pollicis of the thenar eminence. In a nutshell, it starts from the medial cord of the brachial plexus, it goes behind the medial epicondyle, it comes to the wrist, goes in front of the flexor retinaculum, through the Guyon's canal, it gives branches. The cubital tunnel syndrome was always called as the commonest area where we get the ulnar nerve involvement. The frequent bending of the elbow, resting on the elbow, rest during long distance driving, running machinery may cause repetitive pressure. And this repetitive pressure is also included in the leprosy. A direct hit on the cubital tunnel may damage the ulnar nerve. In the Guyon's canal, it is the cyst in the canal, the clotting of the ulnar artery, the fracture of the Hammett bone. So commonly it is the what's called as the ganglion, which is causing the Guyon's canal syndrome. It can be due to osteoarthritis of the wrist bones. The site of the compression is at the level of the elbow, the Struthers, the medial epicondyle, olecranon groove, the cubital tunnel, the anomalous anconeus, and the flexor pronator aponeurosis. The Guyon's canal is the most important point. The ulnar tunnel syndrome and piezo-Hammett ligament concussion, and the most common is in the Guyon's canal is the ganglion, the cyst, and the tumor, aneurysm, the fracture of the hook of the Hammett. This is where it is occurring. And the involvement of the dorsal sensory branch indicate compression at the proximal to the Guyon's canal. The risk factors include trauma, the major, where weightlifters, if they are not able to withhold the, then there can be a severe dislocation and ulnar nerve palsy. And occupational diseases, and bedridden patients who have anesthetic, and bony deformities and rheumatoid arthritis around the elbow joint. Some of the precipitating factors like shallow groove, the valgus deformity, what's called as late ulnar nerve palsy tardy, the soft tissue masses around the medial epicondyle, ulnar nerve prolapse, alcoholism, and diabetes mellitus. These are the 2 additional pictures where you can find ulnar nerve palsy. The most important part of the clinical examination is the paresthesia of the medial part of the both the sides of the little finger and the medial part of the ring finger. It is the tip of the little finger which has got the sensations loss, called as autonomous zone for the ulnar nerve. Then weakness of the grip, dropping of the objects from the hand, the clawing of the fingers. We can see here, so where the patient has got metacarpopharyngeal joint extension and distal two phalanges going for flexion, the classical claw hand. The tardy ulnar develops can develop later where the patient has got malunated supracondylar fracture, where the patient can have a fracture of the lateral epicondyle where it has gone for non-union, the medial side goes on growing and patient develops a cubitus valgus and a late ulnar nerve palsy. It can occur in dislocation of the elbow joint, the contusion of the nerves. The various classification, which is the most commonly is the Sedans classification, the neuropraxia, the axonotomesis where the axons are cut, the neurotomesis where the nerve is completely cut into two parts. The Sunderland's classification of grade 1 to grade 5, the grade 1 is the first degree neuropraxia, the grade 2 is the second degree axonotomesis, third is third degree axonotomesis plus endoneurium, the fourth is fourth degree axonotomesis plus endoneurium plus perineurium. In the fifth, there is a complete nerve cut. So there are various forms of how the nerve is cut from neuropraxia to complete axonotomesis. The diagnosis is by history examination and look for the risk factors and the neurological examination of the upper limb. The examination ulnar nerve where it supplies all the palmar intrachea and the medial two lumbricals, look for the abduction of the index finger, the first dorsal intrachea, and look for the power of the hand. Then we have the Froment sign, well it's also called as the book test. Patient has got a normal able to hold the thumb. Here there is a flexion of the distal IP joint. So this is called as Froment sign for ulnar nerve palsy. The CAR test between the two fingers to find out whether the patient can have a good adduction of the fingers done by palmar intrachea muscles. The lumbrical muscles is tested by doing the extension of the two phalanges by supporting the proximal phalanx. Hold it the proximal phalanx dorsally and ask the patient to do extension of the two phalanges, which he cannot do because of loss of two lumbrical muscles. The lumbricals and the intrachea, they form the flexion of the MCP and extension of the two IP joints. The examination of the what's called as the adductor pollicis by doing adduction of the thumb. We should differentiate whether the ulnar nerve is what's called a high ulnar and low ulnar. The high ulnar, if you have involvement of the flexor carpi ulnaris, the low ulnar escapes the flexor carpi ulnaris, example in Gans canal or in the patient who has got below the disjoint. A classical extensor test wherein patient has got extension of the metacarpopharyngeal joint and flexion of the IP joints. The basic concept is put the proximal phalanx into extension, automatically the whole thing will come to normal. All the surgeries are based in making the MCP extension. The other tests like the Froment sign, the making a wish sign, Tenel sign. So the important is loss of 1.5 finger sensations. It is most important. The differential diagnosis like the cervical root lesion, thoracic outgrowth syndrome, vascular lesions, brachial plexus anomalies. The investigations includes nerve conduction velocity. The normal conduction velocity is 50 meters per second. The fibrillation potentials like various regenerations. EMG is also very useful. And the management. In the conservative treatment, you treat with what's called as this support to the elbow joint. The operative treatment includes whenever the patient has got ulnar nerve, you have to transfer the ulnar nerve anteriorly, what's called as anterior transposition of the ulnar nerve anteriorly, shift it anteriorly. So in case of Gans canal compression with the whatever the cyst or the ganglion, you put an incision zigzag and take out the ganglion from that area. So various other options of involvement is by doing a capsulodesis, So this is another case where the patient has got the pre-operative examination, where the patient has got a good sir report. So patient, if the patient has got ulnar nodal palsy, you can take FDS of the ring finger, make into four tiles, and through the lumbricular canal, it's inserted into all the radial, except in the little finger, it is to the medial side. So results after the tendon transfer, they are quite excellent. And the pre-operative and post-operative Fowler's tenodesis by taking the extensor carpal nares and the extensor indices by making two slips. Pre-operative, post-operative. The Paul Brand's technique, we are taking ECRB, the extensor carpi radialis longus, with one more tendon palmaris longus, and insert into the lumbrical canal into the volar words. The results are quite excellent. Thank you. The importance of the ulnar nerve is you try to treat conservatively. If there is no improvement, you can always consider doing a tendon transfer. Tendon transfer gives a very good results in case of the ulnar nerve palsy. The original modification of leprosy tendon transfers has been taken into traumatic ulnar nerve palsy. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.